Many were surprised, others disappointed when Ombudsman Merceditas Gutierrez tendered her resignation. To some, it was the right thing to do, but to those who were looking forward to the real-life drama of the impeachment trial in the Senate, they considered it anticlimactic. With the Ombudsman's sudden move, questions are left unanswered. What could have driven Mercy to suddenly let go of something she was clinging to with her life only months ago, while critics pressed her to throw in the towel? Could it be another move to protect former President Gloria Arroyo, who allegedly was the real target in the Ombudsman's impeachment trial? Questions and more questions as we try to get the answers. Join us as we go behind the scenes of the political battlefields. I'm your host, Gigi Grande, sitting in for Pia Ontiveros. This is Strictly Politics. Joining us in the studio, Attorney Tomas Sequia, the spokesperson for Ombudsman Merceditas Gutierrez, Bayan Muna Representative Nery Colmenares, Secretary Edwin Lacerda, the presidential spokesperson, and Professor June Salipsip of the Institute for Strategic and International Studies. Good evening, and thanks for joining us.
Good evening.
Good evening.
So my first question goes to you. I want to know, how is the Ombudsman doing? She's admitted before that she's lost sleep over this.
Yes.
How is she doing now?
Well, now I think she's slowly coping with it. She met the staff again today. I saw she packed away her stuff already, her things in the office. But you can see there's a little bit of maybe a relief from the face and the actions of the Ombudsman. Mm-hmm. I think knowing that now she will be a private citizen after 37 years in public service.
Mm-hmm.
So she's beginning to cope up.
You joined her quite recently.
Yes.
Did the news of her resignation take you by surprise?
Yes, actually, we found out about it quite late, also last week, mm-hmm. when she decided to have a brainstorming session on the pros and cons of resignation. So we always believed that she would carry this all the way to the end.
Mm-hmm.
So when she told us, what other options do we have? Then we took that as a sign that maybe she's looking at resignation. So we had to see what are the pros and what are the cons.
That was on which day of last week?
Maybe Tuesday, Wednesday.
Tuesday or Wednesday.
Yes, yes.
And Secretary Lacerda, what about you? Did you see it coming?
Thursday, there was a column by the Ombudsman in Business World, mm-hmm. and she spoke about resignation. You wouldn't notice it because the first part was dealing about scriptures.
Mm-hmm.
But towards the middle part, there was some mention about resignation. But, you know, knowing that we never knew that the Ombudsman was really going to take a different position. She's always taken a hardline stand that I'm going to defend myself in the Senate,
right.
So we never expected it to be so soon. So we heard about it that the day itself.
When did she make that call requesting to see the president?
She made the call to the private office of the president sometime around 7 in the evening.
Of the night before, Thursday night.
Before, asked for an appointment with the president. And so the Yusek Ahoro, mm-hmm. scheduled a 10 a.m. meeting with the president.
Mm-hmm.
So a Friday came, the president met with the Ombudsman at 10:20.
Mm-hmm.
It was a closed door meeting,
mm-hmm.
together with just the Ombudsman, the president, and Secretary Butchabad.
Mm-hmm.
And they spoke for about 10:55. And mm-hmm. she came out, she was smiling. We were there.
Now, I saw those photographs that were released by the palace, and one of the photos shows her signing a document. What was that document, Attorney Sequia?
I think that was the resignation paper.
So, first they talked, they had a long talk, and then she signed the document.
We're not sure what with the process,
yes.
how it happened.
But based on the photos that were given by the palace, the order of the photos, it would look like first they had a bit of a talk and then we see her signing. So she came there.
I remember there was a bit of a discussion as to what the discussion is. We don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But towards the latter part, Secretary Butchabad came out and asked for the photographer to come in.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where the photographer took those shots.
So what do you think, Congressman Colmenares, what do you think might have taken place before the resignation? That's a little bit unusual, don't you think, that you come in with an unsigned resignation letter?
Yes. Actually, we were surprised ourselves. I was surprised that she resigned after all this talk of fighting with strong defense. And then the resignation news came. Mm-hmm. And you're right, the signing itself, right after the talk or during the talks, we also noticed that. Mm. And we're thinking, was she really prepared to resign when she went there? Or mm-hmm. did she say something before she signed the document?
Could there have been negotiations before the signing of
No,
the
she wanted to show to the president that I'm resigning in your presence. That's the reason why she decided to sign before the president. Mm-hmm. President, and that's the only reason why she decided to do so.
Yes, okay. And if I may, in fact, even the night before she was telling us that is her wish, to be able to, hopefully the president will accommodate her such a very short notice, because mm-hmm. she wanted to be the one personally to go to the chief executive and sign before the chief executive. Because mm-hmm. she said, I think that is a proper thing to do and a respectful thing to do.
Okay.
So that was her only wish. She was hoping that such a short notice will be granted.
Any concessions, deals made beforehand?
No. Well, the only concession was, can she keep her security detail? If we can even call that a concession.
Tell us about that. I was a little bit surprised to hear about her request to keep her security detail. What is she concerned about?
I think, like most ombudsmen, probably they would have investigated powerful people and probably they really threats to the life and security of the ombudsman, mm-hmm. any ombudsman for that matter. Mm-hmm. So I think it is a valid request. I think the law, I think, allows it. If I'm not mistaken.
But in her case, and I'm only basing this for like the past year, her office has been very, very active about sending press releases as to the people they've recommended for prosecution, the filing of cases. They're usually small fry. Who is the big fish that she might be fearing? Which would be reason for her to want a security detail?
Well, I wouldn't know.
You know, in fairness to the ombudsman, and I refer to the office, not to any particular individual mm-hmm. occupying the... it's really a difficult job. Mm-hmm. It's a company with death threats. You're going to prosecute people big or small. Mm-hmm. So it's natural that you would have to have a security detail. I remember, for instance, that Sonny Marcello also had his security detail, because it's unavoidable that there'll be threats in your life.
So. And who would pay for it after she resigns?
The
who would be footing the bill for the...
I think Congressman is correct. It's the government.
The government. I think they're allowed.
Security. So this is pretty standard.
I think so. I think it's pretty standard. And I don't have any problems myself with her having security uh-huh. After she resigns.
Okay.
But the problem I'd like to pose here, and maybe... it's not something you even ask a president about mm-hmm. when you're about to resign. It's a simple detail that mm-hmm. takes care of itself. Mm-hmm. I don't even need to mention it. Sir President, tendering my resignation. Can you please give me security details after this? So, but anyway, we don't know what happened there. And the minority leader is alleging that there was a quid pro quo or something. Mm-hmm. I don't know where he got his information. Mm-hmm. But for me, the best thing for the president to do is to not show any signs that he conceded something mm-hmm. to the ombudsman, because that would probably be a bit unacceptable to some.
Mm-hmm.
We believe the case was strong. The impeachment case was strong. There was no need to negotiate anything.
Are you disappointed that the impeachment trial is not going to push
Well, we're actually... I'm very happy that the intent of the impeachment, which is to remove her from office, has been achieved. Mm-hmm. For me, that's it. Mm-hmm. Of course, many are still, wanting to know what really happened. I would be very curious as to what her strong defense was. She has always been mentioning, we have evidence to prove you have strong defense. And we were just thinking, how will she get out of these 6 years of preliminary investigation? Mm-hmm. There's no defense to it. But anyway, we will never know now what her defense was until and unless somebody probably files a case against her in Sandigan Bayan.
When the ombudsman resigned, she said, I remember clearly that she said that she had decided to put the interests of her family, her office, and the nation above her personal interests. Professor June, do you think it was really all that simple?
I don't think so. I think that Ms. Mercedita Gutierrez is a very analytical person, and I think it was a stroke of genius that she resigned. She called the president and resigned to the president. Mm-hmm. Because I think from the very beginning, the way I look at her, she plans her moves. Mm-hmm. And so she calculates every move that she makes, so that she waits for things to happen and then she calculates what moves to make. And I think to a certain extent, the last move that she made going to the president was a stroke of genius, because nobody expected that. Not only that, it was a message to the president that, well, okay, I recognize you as the president. I'm here to submit my resignation, because he's been asking for her to resign. Mm-hmm. So she went straight to the lion's den and said, mm-hmm. okay, here's my resignation. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, she was sending a message to the president, says, and can I keep my security? Mm-hmm. So it's almost like, well, you know, this is now my position. She's keeping the door open. Mm-hmm. I don't know for what, because she's planning her next move again. So I think she's very smart.
Okay. Well, yesterday, Congressman Colmenares, you had some information that you gave out to the media about 7 appointments that were made mm-hmm. by the ombudsman mm-hmm. before, just before she decided to give up her position. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us, help us understand the significance of that?
Well, the significance is for a long time these positions were there. Her plantilla grew. That's why that was part of our preparation for the impeachment. From 4 assistant ombudsmen, mm-hmm. it became 7 under her, and now it's 14 under her term. No, so she could not say, "Well, we lack personnel." Mm-hmm. The problem is, she asked for 14 assistant ombudsmen, and that's in the staffing summary of the ombudsman, mm-hmm. by the way. And yet did not fill this up until she's about to resign. Mm-hmm. As if she's looking at persons. I don't think na pito, lahat-lahat na isip mo, i-appoint mo sila lahat. These things come, you know, 2 or 1 or 3, you know, it's... So, para sa akin, it's really, first, she should not have appointed when she's about to resign. Mm-hmm. You leave it to the new ombudsman mm-hmm. to decide on the structure of the office. If the new ombudsman thinks that I would bring in fresh, credible, new faces, that's the option of the ombudsman. Mm-hmm. Para ka na kasing presidente na lame duck. Mm-hmm. Paalis ka na. Mag-appoint ka pa ng midnight appointments ka pa na dapat bagong presidente nang gumawa noon.
Attorney Sikia, were they midnight appointments?
Well, I would say that they were midnight appointments, like there's a vacancy and at the last minute you appoint. Mm-hmm. I think like in any government institution, there's a process. In fact, these vacancies were published and then the applicants applied for it mm-hmm. and then there's a selection board that they will interview, and then they will rate you, and then depending on the rating, there's a recommendation. Mm-hmm. And most of these, and the records will show it, Congressman, the ones appointed were career. One of them, in fact, was 22 years in the office. Mm-hmm. One was 19, one was 10 years. So all of these were career government officials who were appointed in fact, the head pass.
In fact, the information I got, yes, of course, there are many career officers there. But some of those appointed were not even the highest career officers in the office.
So there were some
merong mga nababypass din. Uh-huh. So it was a deep selection that the information got to us. Kasi marami namang career officers.
But, sir, don't you think it could be argued that the ombudsman, because she has been in this office for the last 4 years, knows the qualifications of her people better than a new ombudsman would?
No, I don't think that's the argument for appointing late or in advance. Mm-hmm. For me, you knew the qualifications of these people a long time ago, mm-hmm. and yet sabay-sabay mo silang inappoint just before you're going to resign.
How influential?
Para sa akin, it's not really very clear na it was based on the merits.
Sir, how important are these positions?
Well, the assistant ombudsman, they, for example, the head of the field investigation office before was an assistant ombudsman, and these are very important, you know. Yung task force Abono, probably, sila ang humahawak ng nitty-gritty ng mga kaso.
Professor June, do you foresee that there might be problems?